All right, welcome to another edition of It's Still Real to Me, our wrestling podcast, Zaslow Show 2.0. Everything Zaslow Show 2.0 is presented by our title sponsor, Anajar and Levine Accident Attorneys. If you're involved in any kind of an accident, slip and fall, motorcycle, automobile, Anajar and Levine Accident Attorneys, 800-747-FREE. That's 800-747-3733. If you're hurt out there from an accident, you go to Anajar and Levine. They treat you like family. This way, you only have to think about your health and all that important stuff. You let them take care of getting you the money that you deserve. Anajar and Levine Accident Attorneys, 800-747-FREE, 800-747-3733. Another big week in the world of pro wrestling. We'll recap it all for you here. My pal is Joey Levin joining us here. Joey, Amanda Nunes retired last night. I just saw this, right?
Yes. And you know, I think for a lot of people, it's probably about time. She has been dominant for so long that it's just maybe they can figure out a way to have some new blood that makes things interesting, because she's I think a lot of people have lost interest in her because of how good she is.
So she won a second belt last night, right?
No. She's had the second belt. So she is the bantamweight champ, 135.
She won that back after losing to Juliana Pena a year or something ago, right?
Yes. Yeah. Which was, a lot of people think, was a fluke. You know, the way Juliana beat her was, you know, she tapped out really quickly. A lot of people think she probably wasn't prepared for that fight. The rematch, she absolutely just dominated Juliana. Like, it was like I don't even know if it's worth having a third round of that. But so the 145 belt, which is her second belt, the featherweight, was a belt that the UFC essentially created for Chris Cyborg. So Chris Cyborg was for a long time recognized as like the most dominant women's fighter ever.
Yeah.
But she was too big to be in the UFC. They didn't have a weight class for her. So they created this belt almost because they're like, all right, we're going to bring her in and make a division around her. And then Newton has knocked her out and won that belt. But then since then, there's no 145 pound women. So she doesn't defend the belt. So Dana basically said last night that division's done.
Okay.
And so they're basically going to retire that belt, and then she retires, and now the 135 belt is open.
Why don't they, you know, I guess the way that UFC always does it, that, you know, they take like the top two contenders and then they fight for the vacant belt. Why don't they take a page out of WWE's book? Why don't they do a tournament? Wouldn't everyone love a tournament?
Well, so Bellator always does tournaments, and that's really the only, at the most, seemingly the only redeeming thing about Bellator, but they do a
Grand Prix. So good.
They do a $1 million Grand Prix. Well, actually, so what they do is they'll do a tournament where the champion is in the tournament. It's not even for the belt. It's for $1 million.
Wow.
And the champion could lose his belt in the second round.
That's cool as hell.
Yeah. Like, the champion is fighting in the tournament, but the tournament is for $1 million. Mm-hmm. Now, I think in the past they have also done, you know, tournaments for belts. And then the other thing that a lot of people seem to like that is gaining a little bit of steam, and obviously Francis Ngannou just signed with the PFL. Jake Paul has a hand in the PFL. PFL does a season, so it's a point system. So the regular season fights, you know, if you win a decision, I think it's a point, and then if you get a finish, you get a certain amount of points or whatever, and then they have a playoffs. So you know, like, for each division, the there's a champion each year. You know, you come in, there's not one person walking around with a belt. There is a champion from last year. That champion doesn't carry over to this year. Now it's a new season. They try to do it like sports.
Yeah.
Where, you know, like Kayla Harrison, she won two seasons in a row. Every time she comes back, if she's in this season, she's not the champ. She's last year's champ this year. And then that person, if they win the season, they're the champion of the PFL and they win $1 million.
That's interesting. All right. Yeah, so I just saw that right before we signed on to do the show, that Amanda Nunes retired. That's big news right there.
Back when UFC started, like way back in the day, they did like one night work tournament. They would do one night tourneys where guys would fight like four fights in a night.
Yeah.
But also back then it was like there was no time. There was no rounds. There was no time. It was just like fight until somebody dies.
I mean, I watched that movie Warrior, you know, with Joel Edgerton and what's his name? Tom Hardy. And that's a tournament. Yeah. And Kurt Angle, you know, he plays the big bad, the undefeated dude. And that movie's awesome. And then they do a tournament, you know, for the grand prize.
There's some interesting MMA like movies and shows out there. There's a show called Kingdom, with Nick Jonas is in it. He's a young MMA fighter, and his dad's like a legendary fighter who runs a gym, and his brother's like a fuck up who's also a really good fighter. It's a pretty interesting show too. A lot more for the drama, but there's some good MMA stuff in there. There's a lot of like random cameos from like MMA legends in there too. It's interesting.
All right. Very good. So, hey, we'll do WWE. We'll do AEW. We actually today, because we're in the middle of the year now, it's June. We're going to look back. I have no recollection of what they were. We're going to look back at our beginning of 2023.
Yeah. Bold predictions,
right?
Yeah.
So, hey, I have no idea what I said.
But we're midway through the year, so I went back and I listened and I wrote down and to see where we're at. And there's some interesting ones.
Okay.
There's some interesting ones. I'll leave it there, and then we'll see later on.
All right. So hey, give me. We had a bunch of Money in the Bank qualifying matches this week. I don't care so much about the matches, but who do we have so far?
Right.
We're just a couple weeks away now. Who do we have so far that are in these matches?
So for the women, it's Becky Lynch, Bayley, Io Sky, Zelina Vega, and Zoe Stark.
And is there, I think there's one more spot.
I think it's one more. So each match currently has five.
Okay.
And I feel like in the past there's been more. Like, I feel like there's been somewhere there's like seven or eight even, but it sounds like this year there's one more.
So let me hear the list again. Say it a little bit slower.
Becky Lynch, Bayley, mm-hmm. Io Sky, Zelina Vega, and Zoe Stark.
Okay, so clearly what's going on here, you know, you could cross off Becky and Zoe Stark. They're both in the match together to continue their feud. Neither one of them are going to win it. They're gonna essentially take each other out as far as the way I see it. And then you have the damage control storyline. You got Bayley and Io Sky in there. What's going to happen between the two of them? Are they going to kind of cancel each other out, even though they're supposed to technically work together, you know? So I feel like they're bringing multiple storylines into this match. And who else did you say is there? I just named four of them.
Zelina.
And Zelina's been the one who I think can win that briefcase. So that kind of plays out the way that I've been thinking.
Well, we also have to see who the sixth person is.
Yeah.
So who do you have any thoughts? Because I have no idea. There's no one that even pops into my mind here.
I mean, it's not
the women.
Be...
I have a couple ideas for the men, but for the women, I have no idea.
Yeah, like the other women you think about are, well, it's a bunch of these women have lost already. Like Sonya has lost. Natalya has lost. A bunch of these women, you know, lost their qualifying matches. So I don't know.
Yeah, but I also think like they need somebody else who you can believe has a chance to win. Like, of these five that are in, the only one that I would be shocked to see win would be Zoe Stark. Like, I don't think the others, I don't think Bayley's winning. But if Bayley won, I wouldn't be shocked.
I could see a scenario where Bayley wins actually because it adds a whole new element of drama to what's going on with damage control.
Or Io. I mean, also Io. I mean, either one of them. I think a lot of people wanted it to be EO. I think there's a big push from the
WWE. It could be EO because then you get the EO Asuka stuff. Now I think EO and Asuka needs to be an actual feud, but right. it could be EO.
Yeah, and it also adds to the damage control stuff of everybody telling Bayley that ever since EO and Dakota joined, they've done nothing.
Right.
Right. But Bayley's holding them down, and now this is her sort of breaking away type of thing. But
Becky and Zoe are a no go. Neither one of them are.
Yeah.
They're in there just to fight with each other.
It wouldn't make sense. That wouldn't make sense. Zelina would be cool. I mean, people would love it. By the way, I you know what's interesting? And I know we're going to, at probably maybe next week or the week after, we're going to do like our top Money in the Bank cash-ins. I was looking back at like the history of Money in the Bank just to remind myself so I can start putting together that list. The women's Money in the Bank, there's only the first one was Alexa,
Carmella.
Right? Carmella. And she held it for like almost a year.
Yeah, it was great.
Ever since then, it's never been held for more than a day.
Well, I hate when they cash it in the same night. Hate when they do that.
Literally, I might be missing it. Maybe there was like a 2-day one or like a week one. But for the most part, other than Carmella, the women's Money in the Bank gets cashed in within Carmella, like 24 hours. Yeah,
Alexa Bliss cashes in immediately. That's happened a couple times.
Nikki A.S.H.?
Yes. Becky handed it over the next day to Asuka because she was pregnant, you know.
Bayley's was quick, I think.
Yeah,
right?
I hate when they do that. And it's happened several times with the men. Like Dean Ambrose cashed it in that night, the night that everyone in the Shield held the title for at least a moment that night. I hate when they do
so, it. So here's the thing. The reason I bring that up is because if Zelina wins, she's got to hold it for like a year. Like, I think she's, because of her underdog story and all that, like, I think she's got to, like, they got to really build up for it to make an impact. She cannot just, like, if she wins this, if she just cashes in the same
night. And
then
it's night, all of a sudden she's the champion. Like, she's it's not.
And then she's just going to lose it at the next pay-per-view. Like, there's got to be some buildup for, like, look, if it's Becky or Bayley and they want to cash in right away, there's some history there. They're champions. So they are champions and they're taking their championship back. But if it's Zelina,
yeah,
we need
to build it up.
I'm okay with it because LWO is hot and we want them to capitalize on it. But you got to build it up.
She's got to be in the story. It's a bigger story, her carrying around the briefcase.
Exactly.
You know, for a few months than her being the champion for like a month. It's a bigger story.
And the briefcase is almost as big as her. It'll be hilarious watching her carry around the briefcase.
So who do we got for the men so far? Who's qualified for the men?
Nakamura, Ricochet, LA Knight, Santos Escobar, and Butch.
Okay, so for me, it's really easy. You got, and they're adding one more, it looks like. For me, it's really easy. Right now, you're looking at LA Knight, obviously, and I think Nakamura can win it. You know, Shinsuke has clearly, after, you know, like several years of just toiling around and doing nothing, Shinsuke has clearly been packaged now as a big star, as a big threat. And yeah, I think for me right now, it's either LA Knight or Nakamura that win it. I don't think the others have a chance. No Ricochet,
Santos,
no Butch.
I think Santos Escobar, certainly, I think.
And you think it could be Santos and Zelina walking around with the briefcase?
Well, no, I think, no. Well, I don't think they both will, but I could see Zelina not winning. For the same reasons, I think I could see Zelina winning. I could see Santos winning. LWO's, they've been huge. And also, like, we love, as much as you like Zelina, and I like Zelina too, and she's been great. It's hard to get her over as, like, a legitimate champion. She's
of course,
so
which is why both of us want her to carry around the briefcase forever.
Right, but Santos Escobar is a champion. Like, that guy comes off as a star, as a champion. He's got a great group with, like, LWO is just awesome. I could definitely see him winning. LA Knight, and here's the thing. Like, actually, I got to look at their ages, but LA Knight and Nakamura are pretty old. Not that that doesn't mean...
LA Knight, I think, is 38 or 39 years old.
Yeah.
Nakamura, I think, is older.
Yeah, no, Nakamura's been around forever. I mean, but not that that doesn't mean that they can't get it and cash in, but the interesting thing about this Money in the Bank, none of these guys have been world champions.
Yeah.
So that is fun.
Well, like, and we also know whichever one of them wins it, they're cashing in on Rollins.
Right.
It ain't Reigns.
Yeah. But so Santos Escobar's 39. I could see any of those things. I actually could see Santos Escobar more than Nakamura. As much as it looks like they're finally packaging Nakamura to be a legit threat or a legit guy in this thing, I just don't.
I can envision this moment where Nakamura cashes in the briefcase and he's sitting on the other side of the ring waiting for, you know, Kinshasa while the champ is hobbled and about to get on his feet. Like, I get to see that moment.
What I'm envisioning is who is the person of this list? And then you have to also imagine there's a sixth person. My fear here is the sixth, and I think I mentioned this to you when I saw you yesterday. My fear is that the sixth person is Riddle, and that Riddle wins.
I hope not.
They sort of teased Riddle being in it a couple weeks ago on Raw when he was backstage. He did a thing with Gunther, and Gunther was like, get in Money in the Bank and go win the briefcase.
Uh-huh.
You know.
And that's another thing, by the way. You better not cash it in on the Intercontinental belt. I know it's been made to a big thing with Gunther. I'm sorry. That doesn't fly with me. I don't like that. Yeah.
But that's my big fear. My big fear is Riddle is the last guy. Now, on the opposite end of the spectrum, my dream, you know what my dream is here for this sixth person?
No, who is it?
Come on, you know.
No, who's your dream?
Chad Gable.
Oh, right.
I mean, that would be the ultimate. But like, I don't.
We're both relieved that Cody is not in the Money in the Bank, right?
Yeah, I mean, I think at this point it wouldn't make a ton of sense.
It just it would have been so predictable. Like, no, he should not be in Money in the Bank. That's never how Cody should win the world titles, by cashing in. That'd be crazy.
Nakamura, wait, did Nakamura? He has been a champion, hasn't he? But he won Royal Rumble.
He won Royal Rumble. He lost WrestleMania 34 to AJ Styles.
Because okay. I was thinking about it, I know he's had a big moment, but what was that? It was Royal Rumble.
Yeah.
So when I'm looking at the list, I'm thinking, okay,
been a champion there either, right?
Right. But what I'm trying to envision is, like, of this list, I'm trying to envision the pop during the cash in. Like, what's going to get the reaction that where the crowd is going to lose their absolute shit
over
this person cashing in?
It's LA Knight.
Of this whole list. Like, there's no one else on this. I mean, I actually think Santos Escobar would get a great reaction. But it's LA Knight. And I don't even think it's particularly close.
And just several months of him carrying around that briefcase and having a microphone in the other hand would be gold.
Yeah.
It really would.
Yeah. Yeah. Yep. I agree. I mean, it's the obvious choice, which is why, again, I fear it may not
obvious
be the choice.
Obvious is okay, though. It's okay.
Yeah,
but obvious.
Sometimes they do. And then sometimes they force Matt Riddle down your throat. So we'll see. I mean, we'll see. I'm not overly optimistic about it. It does seem like he's got a really good shot, though.
So the other big story that I took this week from WWE, well, I guess there's two other big stories, obviously the Bloodline stuff, but to me, the most interesting story that took place this week on WWE was in the main event of Raw. And so the main event was Rollins versus Priest for the title. Rollins wins, great match. Priest continues to kind of solidify himself as a main event guy. Even though he keeps losing, he's having a great run here, all right?
Yeah.
And here is the interesting part. So you've been saying now for a couple months that you think we're eventually leaning toward Finn being kicked out of Judgment Day. Damian Priest is about to be kicked out of Judgment Day, dude. It's Priest that's about to get kicked out. You saw in the match there with Priest where Finn tries to help him, and Damian, like a babyface, turns to him and says, "What are you doing? I don't need your help." And then Damian winds up losing. Finn goes face to face with Rollins. Okay, fine. And then after the match, now this was off the air, and you know, sometimes they'll test stuff. You get to see crowd reaction off the air. Priest, full on babyface, in the ring, shaking hands with Seth Rollins after the match.
Yeah.
They're about to kick out Damian Priest.
Okay, that's fine. That's cool. I think it's kind of a mistake because
I think it's a mistake too.
I think Finn can leave the group and be a babyface.
Yeah.
I don't think Damian Priest is ready to just be on his own as a babyface.
Well, my problem is, where is the muscle in Judgment Day if they kick Priest out?
Well, it's Rhea, right? Rhea wants to get beat up
But there's got to be muscle to fight the men.
JD McDonagh. I don't know. I agree. I mean, it's a weird group without Damian Priest.
It is. I agree.
Which is interesting because I think when this group first started, everyone looked at Damian Priest as just sort of like the afterthought, the heavy, like whatever.
No, I think I think he keeps it together.
But if he's not there, it's weird. Although him and Finn is that's a great program. There'll be some great matches there.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, I don't really know. And maybe everyone just goes their separate ways. Maybe Judgment Day is just gone.
But wouldn't that be crazy? Like, they're so – why would you break up a faction that's red hot?
I'm telling you, I get what you're saying about Damian Priest getting kicked out. I still think it's Finn. I think it's Finn, and I think it's the younger members of the crew are saying, like, why do you keep messing this up?
But what do you make out of Damian going full-on babyface there?
I don't know. Well, babyface after the show. That's after the show.
No, but right. In the match, he turned to Finn and said, "What are you doing? I don't need your help.
Right,
why are you here?"
Yeah, that doesn't necessarily mean – well, yeah, I see what you're saying. Yeah, I don't know. It's interesting. I mean, Maybe they are. I don't know. It's an interesting thing because I don't see a scenario where it works out very well for that group if they kick Damian Priest.
I agree. But it's like that's what I was watching on Monday.
But aren't we almost to the point with the group where there's two different parts of the group already at this point?
Like, yeah, but I think that's okay.
There's Finn and Damian, and then there's Rhea and Dominic, and they have their own whole other thing.
Yeah.
I mean, it doesn't really seem like they're all together that much anyways. I mean, they are, but they're not, you know?
Yeah, yeah.
They got to introduce another member soon. I mean, I think that's the only thing. It's like, but replacing Damian Priest with JD McDonagh doesn't really work.
I don't think that works.
Doesn't really do it. But replacing Finn with JD McDonagh does.
Right, that you could do that, yeah. But that's not what I was watching Monday night. That's not what I saw.
It's good stuff. It's very interesting. Yeah.
Yeah. So, hey, did you dig what?
I was going to say on Monday night, though. I mean, I don't know if we were going to talk about it, but shout out Kevin Owens and Gunther. I mean, that's a pay-per-view match.
Yeah. That was on free TV.
That was an incredible match.
Yeah.
Be sort of like a throw. I mean, not a throwaway. It advances the storyline.
Yeah, well, it's about Imperium going after the tag titles.
Right. But still, I mean, it was a great televised free match just to be on a random Raw. It was so good.
Yeah, like if Kevin Owens weren't a tag champ, you could see them having a pay-per-view match and Kevin Owens beating him.
Oh, absolutely. And you know what? If somebody's going to beat, I mean, there's very few guys at this point where you're like, I think they it would be reasonable to see them take the belt off Gunther
for sure.
Yeah, for sure. So maybe it sets that up in the future, which is great. But I just wanted to point that. I mean, that was if you haven't watched Raw from this week, it's worth just going back and watching that match.
Yeah.
I mean, that was a great match.
Now I'm a big Charlotte Flair fan, so I love whenever she's involved. All right, were you good with her coming interrupting? You get a surprise there. Asuka gets the new belt. Which, by the way, I mean, I'm hanging on for like a month and a half here wondering what the hell they're going to do. But we finally saw, okay, they're not swapping the Raw and SmackDown titles. They're just going to essentially replace them. I like that. I like the way that they had. I wish that I knew, you know, quicker. But I like the way that they ended up doing that.
Yeah, I'm fine with Charlotte. I mean, if she, like, we always talk about this. If she's going to be there, she's going to be going after a belt.
Yeah.
And that's, she's the best ever. She is, you know, so she's got to be involved in some way.
Yeah, I'm totally
good. I'm interested in the belts. So they announced Asuka's first, and it's gold. You know, with the men's belts, it's very clear one is more important than the other. Are we implying Asuka's is the women's title and Charlotte's going after Asuka? Is Asuka's title more important than Rhea's?
I think the only reason that we think that we know one is more important than the other is because Roman has the one. That's why. Otherwise, it's not supposed to be that one is more important than the other.
Right.
It's just that Roman has it. So I don't see it that way with the women. I think there's – and so are we going to get a new one for Rhea tomorrow night, I suppose?
I don't know if it's tomorrow, but it's going to – I mean, it has to happen. It wouldn't make sense for there to be a smack. There's a SmackDown championship on Raw, and then there's not even a Raw championship on SmackDown.
I'm just ultimately glad that they didn't swap belts because it's such
– Yeah, I mean, this is all part of their, I guess, consolidating or streamlining the belts for WWE because now – so the women – that the Raw title is now the women's title, and then the tag titles are going to get – combined, and then we'll have three titles for the women, and that's fine.
Has it been announced that it's Asuka and Charlotte at Money in the Bank? Because I feel like we're headed toward a triple threat, right?
I think that feels like what it's going to be, and that's what I was going to say is I think the what's probably equally as fun to me about Charlotte coming back is that it's going to quickly advance this Bianca heel turn.
Right, we're slowly headed toward the Bianca heel turn.
I think they're moving it pretty quick. She's dressed in all black backstage. She's kind of talking
and
the way
she's got
she
an attitude
in NXT.
Now. Yeah. Yep.
It was coming pretty quickly, which is it's been needed for a while because Asuka, as hard as they try, they can't get her over as a heel. Like, she's not a heel. Everyone loves her. And then within this trip, this three-way rivalry or feud or whatever, Charlotte is also a heel that
Charlotte's, you know, never gonna be babyface.
She's gonna continue to try to be a face, but everyone wants her to be a heel. Asuka is the face of this whole program. So it would be good to have these two monster heels going after Asuka.
Yeah.
So I like it. I'm Bianca. You know how I feel about Bianca. She has needed this for a long time. She has been.
And she's a great heel. People haven't seen her in WWE as a heel. She's a great heel in NXT. She's a great heel.
I think she's just, for a while now, she has just, I mean, great wrestler. Very boring. Very boring. But it's stale. All so right. This is it. She's needed it. So I like it. And I think Charlotte coming back just pushes it even further.
Finally, the Bloodline. I mean, that was the main story of the night on Friday night. But no Roman Reigns. Not really a ton there. I mean, obviously, it's about Jay. What's he going to do? What decisions he going to make? Jimmy winds up costing him, unfortunately, at the end of the night. Super kicks him in the face. Solo beats the shit out of Jimmy. And it's all about Jay still not knowing who he wants to side with, his brother or with the tribal chief. I'm leaning in the direction he's going to go with the tribal chief because it really seems that Paul Heyman is kind of manipulating. He's the puppet master. He's pulling the strings here, and he's happy now that, like, he's trying to get it through Jay's mind that it's your brother's fault. Your brother's the one who's been holding you back, and now he just costs him the United States title.
Well, first of all, I'm just going to say, like, I can't believe you're going to tell me that the main story on Friday night is the Bloodline when we finally have Karrion Kross versus AJ Styles. And we've all been waiting for Karrion Kross versus AJ Styles.
I like what they did there, though.
You're going to tell me Bloodline is more important than Karrion Kross and AJ Styles?
I liked Scarlett blowing the bullshit in AJ's
whatever.
Name. I like
it,
that.
You know what? What did you make of the Jey Uso? The one thing that that struck me was backstage when it was just him and Heyman, and he was like, he said, what did he say? He said, like, oh, gee, if I'm in the Bloodline, that means you're not in the Bloodline.
Right.
Well, what did that mean? What is he saying? Like, if he becomes the tribal chief, Heyman's gone?
I didn't look at it that far. I looked at it more like, if I'm going to still be in the Bloodline, I'm going to do everything I can to make sure that you're out.
Right. You know? Right. Yeah. But it, that's interesting to me. I think that's an interesting little side storyline there, because has he ever, I mean, I guess now, obviously, because there's like this rift. Has he ever, like, openly been, like, against Heyman?
Oh, yeah. Because they're bringing everything back full circle. The beginning of the Bloodline.
Oh, yeah. I guess
Jay
the very
versus
beginning.
Roman.
Yeah, yeah. Right.
And
right.
also at the very beginning was, we don't trust you at Paul
That's
Heyman.
That's right. That's
it
right.
It took a long time for Jay to be okay with Paul Heyman. So they're bringing everything. And it really seems like we're heading in a direction then where Jay is going to wind up being right about everything. Like, Roman sucks. Paul Heyman's eventually going to turn on the Bloodline or on Roman, and it's all going to wind up looking at Jay having been right about everything from the get-go.
You know who Heyman's going to go? You know who Heyman's next guy is?
I don't. I was thinking about it, but I don't.
It's Damian Priest.
Oh, maybe.
Remember that little interaction they had in the ring a few weeks ago? Maybe. Where the Bloodline hired the Judgment Day, and Finn Balor had this look on his face like, what? And it was Heyman and Priest who made the deal. And Finn kind of had this look like, you guys are making deals.
Maybe. Like, and it kind of looks like that Damian is going to have a babyface run here the same way that it was looking like it when Roman returned. And then all of a sudden, when you align yourself with Paul Heyman, you're obviously not a babyface.
Huh. All right. Well, maybe that's where it is. And then we can eventually have the hug that I talked about last week, where Roman and Jay hug it out eventually, and now we just have this massive babyface run for Roman to sort of finish things up.
Maybe that's the direction we're going.
But in the short term, it does seem. I mean, I would imagine we're still headed towards Jimmy and Jay versus Roman and Solo at Money in the Bank, right?
It's only a few weeks away.
I mean, we got to have some type of resolution. Like, he's got to choose just for the sake of money in the, just for the sake of the pay-per-view. He has to choose Jimmy, right? Because then if he chooses Roman, then what is it? Jimmy and Roman?
Well, yeah, I mean, there's definitely something going on there, because this week Paul Heyman told Jay to make sure you got your passport because the tribal chief is sending you to London.
Right. So Jimmy versus Jay? But just Roman's got to be on Money in the Bank, right?
I don't think he has to be, because I could see them putting together a scenario where we're going to feature the world championship. That's the main event. That's the main belt. Like, even if Roman's not defending.
Do we have that yet? Do we know who that's going to be yet?
No.
At Money in the Bank?
No, not yet. No.
Interesting.
But I could see that being the scenario where it's like, hey, let's feature this belt as the main event in the pay-per-view.
Huh. And then we just don't have Roman until SummerSlam for whatever he's going to do?
Yeah, maybe. Yeah, maybe.
Which we still, it's still like, we're still at a point with Roman where there's nobody even talking to Roman other than the Bloodline.
Right. His title is not up for grabs.
It's not
right
active.
Now.
It's not active.
It's not active right now. It's not active.
Well, also, what we didn't get to see this week because he wasn't on the show was what titles does he even have? Because remember because we were discussing last week after they introduced the new title,
it'll be interesting the next time he comes out from the back how many titles he's holding.
Right. Is he holding two? Is he holding three? Is he holding one?
I think he's going to have them all.
He's going to have the old Universal title also.
Yep. I don't think that's going to be up for grabs when he fights, but I think he's going to have all the titles out with him. I do.
That's hilarious.
Yeah.
If that is the case, it's absurd, but it's also, it's a great little wrinkle to his like mental decaying and him going crazy. Is like, I still have all the gold.
Yep.
Like, I'm still the grand champion of everything. Look at all my belts.
Yep.
It would be fun, but I will see. He's got to be on TV next week. They're not going to go 2 weeks without him being on TV, I don't think.
I don't know.
I guess maybe they can. I don't know.
They definitely
I just
can.
Never really know with Roman anymore.
Yeah, I don't know. I thought he was going to be on the show this week. So I don't know.
So did I. I thought he had to like address to
That's
Roman whether he was making his decision.
Instead of us getting call Roman Reigns.
I love that. He does it every week now. It's so funny. Heyman's the best. Heyman, he's the best. So.